This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. President of the United States Presidency Scandals Reforms Peace Policy Judicial Appointments Post-Presidency Later Life Memoirs Tomb Memorial Depictions V.E. The presidency of Ulysses S. Grant began during the turbulent Reconstruction period following the American Civil War. Grant was elected the 18th President of the United States in 1868 and was re-elected to the office in 1872, serving from March 4, 1869, to March 4, 1877. Grant was a Republican, and his main supporters were the radical and stalwart factions. The United States was at peace with the world throughout the era, and was prosperous until the Panic of 1873, a severe national depression, that dominated Grant's second term. Grant bolstered the executive branch's enforcement powers by signing into law the Department of Justice and Office of Solicitor General that was implemented to protect the civil rights of African Americans. Grant expanded federal authority that protected African American civil rights against domestic terrorism in the South. Grant's presidency represented the Civil War values that included union, freedom and equality. Grant's Reconstruction policy, however, was challenged by the complexities of using the U.S. Army to impose democracy and legal equality regardless of the resistance of Democrats in the South. Grant worked hard to ensure the passage of the 15th Amendment that gave black men the right to vote. Grant's notable efforts as president included civil rights, civil service reform, and Indian policy. Grant's foreign policy under Hamilton Fish was successful and improved Anglo-American relations. Grant was opposed by the liberal faction of the Republican Party, many of them founding fathers of the GOP, who denounced Grant for violating the party's emphasis on fighting corruption. The liberals insisted that Reconstruction had been successful, that slavery and secessionism were dead. Liberals demanded that army troops should be withdrawn from the South so that normal political life could resume. The liberals nominated longtime Republican spokesman Horace Greeley in 1872, depriving Grant of the intellectual base of the Republican Party. Greeley was quietly supported by the Democrats, but was decisively defeated by Grant rather than develop a cadre of trustworthy political advisors. Grant was overconfident in choosing his cabinet. He relied heavily on former Army associates who had a thin understanding of politics and a weak sense of civilian ethics. His presidential reputation was severely damaged by repeated scandals and frauds. Having struggled to be a self-made man, Grant was extremely loyal to himself and his family, while trusting of close military associates that in turn caused dissension among reformers whom he believed were plotting to overthrow his presidency. Grant dismissed three cabinet members without notice or explanation. Two of his cabinet secretaries, War and Navy, his personal secretary, and high officials he named to the Treasury Department joined federal bribery or tax evasion syndicates. Corruption charges were rampant in the Department of the Interior in 1874, until Grant appointed a reformer. Grant often defended the culprits, rather than the integrity of government service, while he attacked their accusers. Middle-class public opinion, a key element in the Republican Party base, turned hostile to Grant. Some scholars, however, maintain that corruption charges were exaggerated during the Grant administration, and that Grant implemented civil service reform and ended the moiety system. Grant played a role in thwarting the Gold Ring in 1869 and the prosecution of the whiskey ring in 1875. His Attorney General Edwards Pierpont and Postmaster General John A. J. Creswell made sweeping reforms in their respected departments, and several of Grant's cabinet initiated civil service in their own departments after a false start with weak selections. Grant named to his cabinet leading reformers including Hamilton Fish, Benjamin Bristow, Alfonso Taft, and Amos T. Ackerman Fish as Secretary of State, negotiated the Treaty of Washington, and was successful at keeping the United States out of trouble with Britain and Spain. Bristow, as Secretary of Treasury, ended the corruption of the whiskey ring where distillers and corrupt officials made millions from tax evasion. Taft, a brilliant jurist as Attorney General, successfully negotiated for bipartisan panel to peacefully settle the controversial election of 1876. Grant and Attorney General Ackerman enforced civil rights legislation that protected African Americans and destroyed the Ku Klux Klan. Grant encouraged peaceful congressional negotiations after the controversial election of 1876. 1876, signed the Electoral Commission Act of 1877, while the Compromise of 1877 ended Reconstruction. Note 1. Economically, Grant was a conservative who favored a hard money, gold-based, anti-inflationary policy that entailed paying off the large national debt with gold. He reduced governmental spending, decreased the federal workforce, and reduced the national debt, while tax revenues increased in the Treasury Department during his second term in office. The Panic of 1873, caused by rampant railroad speculation, shook the nation's financial institutions. Banks failed, prices fell, and unemployment surged before the panic. There had been 8 years of tremendous industrial growth after the Civil War that fueled lavish money-making schemes, personal greed, and national corruption. President Grant's contraction of money supply worsened the panic. The ensuing major U.S. depression that followed lasted for 5 years, causing massive economic damage to the country. The panic wiped out both the fortunes of business and corruption. Southern Reconstruction continued that included escalated sectional violence over the status of freedmen and fractured state party alliances and elections. With the completion of the Transcontinental Railroad in 1869, the West was wide open to expansionism that sometimes was challenged by hostile Native Americans. Grant implemented an innovative peace policy, though not always successful, with Native Americans. Hostilities took place with the Modoc War, the Red River War, and the Great Sioux War that culminated with the famous Battle of Little Bighorn, where Lieutenant Colonel George Armstrong Custer was killed in 1874. Millions of buffalo were being slaughtered to make room for settlers and ranchers. Grant, who favored ranchers' land use for domestic cattle, rejected legislation that would have limited the slaughter of the bison after the fatal Modoc Peace Commission in 1873. Grant's Native American policy incorporated the military strategies favored by William T. Sherman and Phil Sheridan. Grant gave legislative support to the early suffragette movement. Corruption was rampant in the Department of Indian Affairs under Secretary of Interior Columbus Delano. However, Grant and Secretary Delano did have success in the establishment of America's first national park, Yellowstone, and the San Carlos Apache Indian Reservation. The Interior Department corruption was cleaned up by Grant's Secretary Zachariah Chandler in 1875. Grant's presidential legacy has suffered due to his heavy-handed use of the U.S. Army to prop up his political allies in southern states. However, since the mid-1990s, his presidential reputation has improved as historians emphasize his enforcement of African American civil rights in the South and his peace policy towards Indians. Contents 1. Presidency 1869-1877-2. Election of 1868-3. First term 1869-1873-3. Cabinet 32. Modified Tenure of Office Act 33. Political Defections 34. Reconstruction and Civil Rights 341. 15th Amendment 342. Department of Justice 343. Naturalization Act of 1870-344. Force Acts of 1870 and 1871-345. Amnesty Act of 1872. 35. Indian Affairs and Human Rights 351. Peace Policy for Indians 3511. Evaluations 352. West Point Hazing Reduced 353. Utah Territory Polygamy 354. Comstock Act 36. Early Suffrage Movement 37. Economy and Treasury Reform 38. Yellowstone, Buffalo, and Conservation 39. Foreign Policies 391. Dominican Republic Annexation Treaty 392. Cuban Insurrection 393. Treaty of Washington 394. Korean Incident 4. Corruption and Reform 1869-1873. 41. Gold Ring Thwarted 42. Civil Service Commission 43. Star Root Postal Ring 44. New York Custom House Ring 45. Salary Grab 5. Election of 1872 6. Second Term 1873-1877-6. Reconstruction 611. Colfax Massacre 612. The Brooks-Baxter War in Arkansas 613. Vicksburg Riots 614. Louisiana Revolt and Coups 615. South Carolina 1876-62. Indian Affairs 621. Modoc War 622. Red River War 623. Bureau of Indian Affairs Corruption 624. Great Sioux War 63 Visited Colorado Territory 64 Civil Rights 641 Civil Rights Act of 1875-642 Polygamy and Chinese Prostitution 65 Secular Education 66 Support for Jews 67 Panic of 1873 68 Economy 681 Vetoes Inflation Bill 682 Resumption of Specie Act 69 Foreign Policy 691 Virginis Affair 692 Hawaiian Free Trade Treaty 693 Liberian Grebo War 7 Corruption and Reform 1873-1877-71 Scandal Cabinet and Appointees 72 Sanborn Contracts 73 Pratt 74 Delano Affair 75 Whiskey Ring Prosecuted 76 Trading Post Ring 77 Catellism 78 Safe Burglary Conspiracy 8 Reforming Cabinet Members 9 Election of 1876 10 Judicial Appointments 11 Administration and Cabinet 111 Supreme Court Appointments 112 States Admitted to the Union 113 Vetoes 114 Government Agencies Instituted 115 Presidential Succession 1875-1877-12 Presidential Reputation 13 Civil Rights Record 14 See also 15 Notes 16 References 17 Sources 171 by author 172 by title Anonymous 173 Newspaper Articles 18 Further reading 181 Primary Sources 182 Yearbooks 19 External links Presidency 1869-1877 President Ulysses S. Grant Brady 1869 Grant's presidency has traditionally been viewed by historians as incompetent and full of corruption. An examination of his presidency reveals Grant had both successes and failures during his two terms in office. In recent years, historians have elevated his presidential rating because of his support for African American civil rights. He leaned heavily toward the radical camp and often sided with their Reconstruction policies, signing into law force acts to prosecute the Ku Klux Klan. In foreign policy, Grant won praise for the Treaty of Washington. Settling the Alabama claims issue with Britain through arbitration. Economically, he sided with Eastern bankers and signed the Public Credit Act that paid U.S. debts in gold specie, but was blamed for the severe economic depression that lasted 1873-1877. Grant, wary of powerful congressional leaders, was the first president to ask for a line-item veto in the century after he left office. Most historians denounced the Reconstruction policies followed by Grant more recently. Grant's support for an enforcement of African Americans' civil rights has earned him praise from scholars. While graft and corruption existed in the southern state governments he supported with the Army, many civil rights advances were made for African Americans. He was vigorous in his enforcement of the 14th and 15th Amendments and prosecuted thousands of persons who violated African American civil rights. He used military force to put down political insurrections in Louisiana, Mississippi, and South Carolina. The Depression of 1873, along with the increasingly unpopular Reconstruction program, weakened his reputation and his party, allowing the resurgent Democrats to gain a majority in the House of Representatives in 1875. His presidency was inundated with many scandals caused by low standards and carelessness with his political appointees and personal associates. Nepotism, practiced by Grant, was unrestrained, with almost 40 family members or relatives who financially benefited from government appointments or employment. Grant and Sumner were often at odds with each other on matters of foreign policy and political patronage. Sumner followed his own foreign policy and detested Grant's practice of nepotism in making political appointments. One historian, Mary L. Hinsdale, described the Grant administration as a most extraordinary array of departures from the normal course and a military rule, in close connection with a select Republican senatorial group in an unsuccessful effort to annex the island country of Santo Domingo. Grant bypassed the State Department by sending his military associate Orville E. Babcock to produce the treaty. Grant disregarded the opinion of Attorney General Ebenezer R. Hoar over the McGarahan mining claim patents. Grant's foreign policy was heavily influenced by the able Secretary of State Hamilton Fish. Grant depended on Fish's advice on domestic issues such as money policy and Reconstruction. His Secretary of Treasury, George Boutwell, was given full charge of national economic policies in 1874. Grant began a series of appointments that included reformers and qualified statesmen to his administration, starting with Benjamin Britten Bristow who prosecuted the Whiskey Ring with the departure of Orville E. Babcock and William W. Belknap from the White House in 1876, the Grant administration took on a civilian rather than military-style election of 1868. Main article, United States presidential election, 1868. Democrat Horatio Seymour, was easily defeated by Grant in the election of 1868. Republicans charged he did not vigorously amend the Civil War while governor of New York. There were two main divisive issues in 1868. The first was the continued Reconstruction of the South. The Democrats advocated allowing former Confederate soldiers to hold elective offices, and the Republicans endorsed the 15th Amendment to the Constitution, which allowed African Americans to vote. The other controversial issue concerned the redemption of war bonds either in gold or paper money known as greenbacks. The Democrats wanted to redeem the bonds with $100 million in greenbacks and the rest with gold. The greenbacks were known as cheap money and would be inflationary. The Republicans wanted to pay the redemption of war bonds only with gold, a position attractive to investors and bankers finding a popular hero who endorsed their Reconstruction policies. The Republicans nominated Grant and Speaker of the House Schuyler Colfax. The Democrats, ignoring politically damaged President Andrew Johnson, who was a political independent, nominated Horatio Seymour, former governor of New York, and Francis P. Blair from Missouri. Seymour was a wealthy conservative who came under GOP attack for weakness during the war and favoring the anti-war copperheads. The campaigning was nasty, as the Republicans waved the bloody shirt of treason against the Democrats as copperheads. Grant himself never campaigned, except for his slogan "Let us have peace" and his apology to Jewish voters for his 1862 General Order No. 11 that banned Jewish merchants from his zone during the Civil War because of alleged profiteering. Grant won with 527% of the popular vote and won by a landslide in the Electoral College with 214 votes to Seymour's 80 votes. Grant was helped by the fact that six Southern states were controlled by radical Republicans who kept many ex-Confederates from voting first term. 1869-1873 Cabinet. Grant sends message to Congress March 5, 1869, nominating his first presidential cabinet. Grant took an unorthodox approach to his cabinet choices, declining to consult with the Senate and keeping his choices secret until he submitted them for confirmation. Grant purposely avoided choosing Republican Party leaders in an effort to create national harmony out of personal loyalty. Grant appointed his friends Elihu B. Washburn to the State Department and John A. Rawlins as Secretary of War. Washburn served only 12 days before resigning over claims of ill health. The plan was designed to give him greater diplomatic clout when Grant appointed him Minister to France. Grant then appointed Hamilton Fish, a conservative New York statesman, as Secretary of State. Fish would be Grant's most successful appointment. His relationship with Fish grew out of a strong friendship between the two men's wives. Rawlins later died of tuberculosis and was replaced by William W. Belknap. Grant selected several non-politicians to his cabinet, including Adolph E. Borah and Ed Stuart. With limited success, Borah served briefly as Secretary of Navy, replaced by George M. Robeson, while Stuart's nomination failed, since as a commercial merchant, he was lawfully prevented from becoming Secretary of Treasury by a 1789 statute. Additionally, Senator Charles Sumner and Senator Roscoe Conkling, in opposition to Grant, refused to amend the law to allow Stuart's appointment in place of Stuart. Grant appointed George S. Boutwell, known for his integrity, as Secretary of Treasury. Grant's other cabinet appointments, Jacob D. Cox Interior, John Cresswell Postmaster General, and Ebenezer Rockwood Hoar Attorney General, were well received and uncontroversial. Grant's independent, at times problematic, manner in choosing his cabinet started a rift between Republican Party veterans who were denied senator consultation. Boutwell's appointment set up a cabinet geographic imbalance, since both Boutwell and Hoar were from Massachusetts. To correct this imbalance, Grant replaced Hoar by Amos T. Ackerman from Georgia as a former commanding general. Grant viewed his cabinet as subordinates, rather than engaging them traditionally in a cordial and confidential manner. Modified tenure of Office Act. Further information, impeachment of Andrew Johnson and Tenure of Office Act 1867. In March 1869, President Grant made it known he desired the Tenure of Office Act repealed, stating it was a stride toward a revolution in our free system. The Tenure of Office Act was passed by Congress in 1867, sponsored by radical Republicans, to curb the power of the President Andrew Johnson in making government office appointments. The controversial law had been invoked during the impeachment trial of Johnson in 1868 on March 5, 1869, a bill was brought before Congress to repeal the act, but Senator Charles Sumner was opposed, unwilling to give Grant a free hand in making appointments. Grant, to bolster the repeal effort, declined to make any new appointments except for vacancies, until the law was overturned, thus, agitating political office seekers to pressure Congress to repeal the law under national pressure for governmental reform. A compromise was reached and a new bill was passed that allowed the president to have complete control over removing his own cabinet. However, government appointees needed the approval of Congress within a 30-day period. Grant, who did not desire a party split over the matter, signed the bill. Afterwards, he received criticism for not getting a full repeal of the law. The unpopular measure was completely repealed in 1887. Grant was criticized for appointing many family members considered unqualified to highly sought government posts, a practice known as nepotism. Political defections. Initially, President Grant was popular among many political and newspaper elite. Political defections began as early as the spring and fall of 1869, when both Charles A. Dana and Henry Adams became critical and discouraged over Grant's presidency in the aftermath of the Black Friday scandal. By 1870, Horace Greeley lost enthusiasm for the administration with the resignations of Attorney General Ebenezer R. Hoar and Ambassador to Britain John L. Motley. Prominent journalists Samuel Bowles, Horace White, E. L. Godkin, and William C. Bryant became concerned over alleged incompetence and lack of national direction from Grant. Personal animosity remained between Charles Sumner and Grant over the Senate rejection of the Santo Domingo Treaty. The common citizen, however, revered Grant for his gallant service in the Civil War. Reconstruction and civil rights. Further information: Reconstruction era of the United States. Frederick Douglass, a civil rights activist, campaigned for Grant in 1868 and 1872 during Reconstruction. Freedmen freed slaves, were given the vote by Congress and became active in state politics. 14 were elected to Congress in state government. They were never governor but did become lieutenant governors or secretaries of state. They formed the voting base of the Republican Party along with some local whites called scalawags and new arrivals from the north called carpetbaggers. Most southern whites opposed the Republicans. They called themselves conservatives or redeemers. Grant repeatedly took a role in state affairs. For example, on December 24, 1869, he established federal military rule in Georgia and restored black legislators who had been expelled from the state legislature. Most historians in the 21st century consider Reconstruction to be a failure. However, historian Mark Summers in 2014 has argued that if we see Reconstruction's purpose as making sure that the main goals of the war would be filled, of a Union held together forever, of a North and South able to work together, of slavery extirpated, and sectional rivalries confined, of a permanent banishment of the fear avaunting appeals to state sovereignty, backed by armed force, then Reconstruction looks like what in that respect it was, a lasting and unappreciated success. 15th Amendment. Further information: 15th Amendment to the United States Constitution. According to biographer William S. McFeely, Grant and many in the North believed the American Civil War extended democracy to the African American freedmen. Grant used political pressure to ensure the states ratified the 15th Amendment, guaranteeing that no citizen can be denied the right to vote based upon race, color, or previous condition of servitude. When it passed, he hailed it as a measure of grander importance than any other one act of the kind from the foundation of our free government to the present day. Many in the South, however, were determined that the African American male's right to vote would be unenforceable. Department of Justice. See also, United States Department of Justice. On June 22, 1872, Grant signed a bill into law passed by Congress that created the Department of Justice and to aid the Attorney General, the Office of Solicitor General. Grant appointed Amos T. Ackerman as Attorney General and Benjamin H. Bristow as America's first Solicitor General. Both Ackerman and Bristow used the Department of Justice to vigorously prosecute Ku Klux Klan members in the early 1870s. In the first few years of Grant's first term in office, there were 1,000 indictments against Klan members with over 550 convictions from the Department of Justice. By 1871, there were 3,000 indictments and 600 convictions, with most only serving brief sentences, while the ringleaders were imprisoned for up to 5 years in the federal penitentiary in Albany, New York. The result was a dramatic decrease in violence in the South. Ackerman gave credit to Grant and told a friend that no one was better or stronger than Grant when it came to prosecuting terrorists. Ackerman's successor, George H. Williams, in December 1871, continued to prosecute the Klan throughout 1872 until the spring of 1873 during Grant's second term in office, Williams' clemency and moratorium on Klan prosecutions was due in part that the Justice Department, having been inundated by Klan outrage cases, did not have the effective manpower to continue the prosecution's Naturalization Act of 1870. On July 14, 1870, Grant signed into law the Naturalization Act of 1870 that allowed persons of African descent to become citizens of the United States. This revised an earlier law, the Naturalization Act of 1790, that only allowed white persons of good moral character to become U.S. citizens. The law also prosecuted persons who used fictitious names, misrepresentations, or identities of deceased individuals when applying for citizenship. Force Acts of 1870 and 1871. President Grant, circa 1870. Further information: Force Act of 1870, Force Act of 1871, and Ku Klux Klan. To add enforcement to the 15th Amendment, Congress passed an act that guaranteed the protection of voting rights of African Americans. Grant signed the bill, known as the Force Act of 1870, into law on May 31, 1870. This law was designed to keep the Redeemers from attacking or threatening African Americans. This act placed severe penalties on persons who used intimidation, bribery, or physical assault to prevent citizens from voting, and placed elections under federal jurisdiction. On January 13, 1871, President Grant submitted to Congress a report on violent acts committed by the Ku Klux Klan in the South. On March 20, President Grant told a reluctant Congress the situation in the South was dire and federal legislation was needed that would secure life, liberty, and property, and the enforcement of law, in all parts of the United States. President Grant stated that the U.S. mail and the collection of revenue was in jeopardy. Congress investigated the Klan's activities and eventually passed the Force Act of 1871 to allow prosecution of the Klan. This act, also known as the Ku Klux Klan Act and written by Representative Benjamin Butler, was passed by Congress to specifically go after local units of the Ku Klux Klan. Although sensitive to charges of establishing a military dictatorship, Grant signed the bill into law on April 20, 1871, after being convinced by Secretary of Treasury George Boutwell that federal protection was warranted. Having cited documented atrocities against the freedmen, this law allowed the president to suspend habeas corpus on armed combinations and conspiracies by the Klan. The act also empowered the president to arrest and break up disguised night marauders. The actions of the Klan were defined as high crimes and acts of rebellion against the United States. The Ku Klux Klan consisted of local secret organizations formed to violently oppose Republican rule during Reconstruction. There was no organization above the local level wearing white hoods to hide their identity. The Klan would attack and threaten Republicans. The Klan was strong in South Carolina between 1868 and 1870. South Carolina Governor Robert K. Scott, who was mired in corruption charges, allowed the Klan to rise to power. Grant, who was fed up with their violent tactics, ordered the Ku Klux Klan to disperse from South Carolina and lay down their arms under the authority of the Enforcement Acts. On October 12, 1871, there was no response, and so on October 17, 1871, Grant issued a suspension of habeas corpus in all the 9 counties in South Carolina. Grant ordered federal troops in the state, who then captured the Klan, who were vigorously prosecuted by At Gen Ackerman and Sol Gen Bristow with the Klan. Destroyed, other white supremacist groups would emerge, including the White League and the Red Shirts. Amnesty Act of 1872. Main article: Amnesty Act of 1872. Texas was readmitted into the Union on March 30, 1870, Mississippi was readmitted February 23, 1870, and Virginia on January 26, 1870. Georgia became the last Confederate state to be readmitted into the Union on July 15, 1870. All members for the House of Representatives and Senate were seated from the 10 Confederate states who seceded. Technically, the United States was again a united country to ease tensions. Grant signed the Amnesty Act of 1872 on May 23, 1872, that gave amnesty to former Confederates. This act allowed most former Confederates, who before the war had taken an oath to uphold the Constitution of the United States, to hold elected public office. Only 500 former Confederates remained unpardonable and therefore forbidden to hold elected public office. Indian Affairs and Human Rights, Peace Policy for Indians. Further information: Cultural Assimilation of Native Americans, Section the South and opening a new era in relations with the Western Indian tribes in a major address, Grant stated, the building of railroads and the access thereby given to all the agricultural and mineral regions of the country is rapidly bringing civilized settlements into contact with all the tribes of Indians no matter what ought to be the relations between such settlements and the Aborigines, the fact is they do not get in together, and one or the other has to give way in the end. A system which looks to the extinction of a race is too abhorrent for a nation to indulge in without entailing upon the wrath of all Christendom, and without engendering in the citizen a disregard for human life, and the rights of others, dangerous to society. I see no remedy for this except in placing all the Indians on large reservations and giving them absolute protection there. Red Cloud first visited Grant at the White House in May, 1870. The goal of his peace policy was to minimize military conflict with the Indians, looking forward to any course toward them which tends to their civilization and ultimate citizenship. Indians were to stay on reservations where they would receive government subsidies and training supervised by religious denominations. Indians were no longer allowed to engage in raids or send war parties off the reservations. The Army's job was to force them back. The goal was to assimilate the Indians into American society. Any Indian could leave the reservation at any time and join the larger society, and have full citizenship. The Indians on reservations were made U.S. citizens in 1924. Grant's peace policy was a sharp reversal of federal policy toward Native Americans. Wars of extermination are demoralizing and wicked, he told Congress in his second inaugural address of 1873. The president lobbied, though not always successfully, to preserve Native American lands from encroachment by the westward advance of pioneers. The economic forces of Western expansionism led to conflicts between Native Americans, settlers, and the U.S. military. Native Americans were increasingly forced to live on reservations. Statistical data of the number of Indian wars per year between 1850 and 1890, revealed that battles decreased during Grant's two terms in office from 101 in 1869 to 43 in 1877. In 1875 there were only 15 battles, the lowest rate since 1853 at 13 battles in 1869. Grant appointed his aide General Ely S. Parker, a Seneca Indian, as the first Native American Commissioner of Indian Affairs during Parker's first year in office. The number of Indian wars per year dropped by 43 from 101 to 58. Chief of the Oglala Sioux Red Cloud wanted to meet President Grant. After learning that Parker was appointed Indian Commissioner, Red Cloud, along with Chief of the Brule Sioux Spotted Tail, came to Washington, D.C. by train and met with Parker and President Grant in 1870. Grant held no personal animosity towards Native Americans and personally treated them with dignity when Red Cloud and Spotted Tail first met. Grant at the White House on May 7, 1870, they were given a bountiful dinner and entertainment equal to what was shown to a young Prince Arthur at a White House visit from Britain in 1869. At their second meeting on May 8, Red Cloud informed Grant that whites were trespassing on Native American lands and that his people needed food and clothing out of concern for Native Americans. Grant ordered all generals in the West to keep intruders off by military force if necessary. To prevent Native American hostilities and wars, Grant lobbied for and signed the Indians Appropriations Act of 1870-1871. This act ended the governmental policy of treating tribes as independent sovereign nations. Native Americans would be treated as individuals or wards of the state, and Indian policies would be legislated by congressional statutes. Historians have debated issues of paternalism and colonialism, but have glossed over the significance of contingencies, inconsistencies, and political competition involved in forging a substantive federal policy. According to scholar David Sim, 2008, he examined the peace policy, emphasizing incoherence in its formulation and implementation, while the Grant administration focused on well-meaning but limited goals of placing good men in positions of influence and convincing Native peoples of their fundamental dependency on the U.S. government. Attempts to create a new departure in federal-Native relations were characterized by conflict and disagreement. According to Sim, the muddled creation of what has become known as the peace policy thus tells much about the varied and divergent attitudes Americans had toward the consolidation of their empire in the West following the Civil War. The innovation in Grant's Native American peace policy was in appointing Quakers as U.S. Indian agents to various posts throughout the nation. This destroyed the power of patronage, as Congress would be reluctant to go after church appointments. On April 10, 1869, Congress created the Board of Indian Commissioners. Grant appointed volunteer members who were eminent for their intelligence and philanthropy. A previous commission had been set up under the Andrew Johnson administration in 1869. 1868 the Grant Board was given extensive power to supervise the Bureau of Indian Affairs and civilized Native Americans after the Piegan Massacre on January 23, 1870, when Major Edward M. Baker killed 173 tribal members, mostly women and children. Grant was determined to divide Native American post appointments up among the religious churches. By 1872, 73 Indian agencies were divided among religious denominations. Quakers or Protestant clergy predominantly controlled most of the Central and Southern Plains Indian territories, while all other surrounding territories were under the control of appointed military officers. Grant's wartime aide, General Ely S. Parker of the Seneca Nation, was the first Native American to be appointed Commissioner of Indian Affairs. He held the office from 1869 to 1871. Evaluations. Congressional reaction to the losses suffered by Lieutenant Colonel George Armstrong Custer's unit at the Battle of the Little Big Horn in 1876 was shock and dismay at the failure of the peace policy. Grant blamed Custer wholly for the defeat, stating that the sacrifice of troops was unnecessary. The Indian Appropriations Measure of August 1876 marked the end of Grant's peace policy. The Sioux were given the choice of either selling their lands in the Black Hills for cash or not receiving government gifts of food and other supplies. The historian Robert M. Utley, 1984, contended that Grant, as a pragmatist, saw no inconsistency with dividing up Native American posts among religious leaders and military officers. He added that Grant's Quaker policy, despite having good intentions, failed to solve the real dilemma of the misunderstandings between the motivations, purposes, and ways of thinking between both white and Native American cultures. These inconsistencies were evident in the breakdown of peace negotiations between the U.S. military and the Modoc tribal leaders during the Modoc War from 1872 to 1873. In 1871, President Grant's Indian peace policy, enforced and coordinated by Brig Gen George Stoneman in Arizona, required the Apache to be put on reservations where they would receive supplies and agriculture education. The Apache slipped out and occasionally raided white settlers. In one raid, believed to have been conducted by Apache warriors, settlers and mail runners were murdered near Tucson, Arizona. The townspeople traced this raid to Apache reservation from Camp Grant. 500 Apache lived at the Camp Grant near Dudleyville, angered over the murders. The Tuscan townspeople hired 92 Papago Indians, 42 Mexicans, and 6 whites to take revenge on the Apache. When the war party reached Camp Grant on April 30, they murdered 144 Apaches, mostly women and children, in what became known as the Camp Grant Massacre. 27 captured Apache children were sold into Mexican slavery in May. An attempt was made by a small federal military party to capture Apache leader Cochise. During the chase, they killed 13 Apache. Grant immediately removed Stoneman of his command in Arizona. Most detrimental to Grant's peace policy was rampant corruption in the Department of the Interior under Secretary of Interior Columbus Delano. During Sec Delano's tenure, federal money intended to supply Native American tribes with food and clothing was skimmed off by corrupt Indian agents and clerks, often allied with traders. In addition, persons posing as Indian attorneys charged Indian tribes money for bogus representation in Washington, D.C. After newspapers exposed Delano's delinquency, Grant defended him rather than investigate the matter. Although Sec Delano supported and defined Grant's Indian peace policy and was instrumental in the creation of the San Carlos Apache Indian Reservation in 1872, he was not a reformer and was careless in his administration of the Department of the Interior. The previous Grant appointment, Secretary Jacob D. Cox, had run the department with efficiency and merit. Cox had been considered to be one of the best Secretaries of Interior in the nation's history. When Cox resigned in 1870, Grant appointed Delano out of patronage considerations to appease stalwart party bosses. After Sec Delano finally resigned in 1875, his replacement, Sec Zachariah Chandler, reformed the Department of the Interior, banned Indian attorneys, and fired the corrupt clerks working in the Department of Indian Affairs. Grant's Secretary of War, William W. Belknap, who was in charge of all Indian trading posts under the Department of War, received illicit profit payments from the Fort Sill Indian tradership. Sec Belknap resigned and was replaced by reformer Alfonso Taft. Belknap was impeached by the House, put on trial in the Senate during the summer of 1876 and acquitted. West Point hazing reduced. Further information, Frederick Dent Grant. While President Grant advocated that African Americans enter the West Point Academy, he initially failed in 1870 and 1871 to protect the first African American West Point Academy cadet, James Albert Smith, from racist hazing by other cadets. This lack of protection was influenced by Grant's son, then West Point cadet Frederick Dent Grant, who participated in the hazing against Smith Major Gen. Thomas H. Ruger, however, was appointed superintendent of West Point in 1871, reformed the academy, having reduced the amount of hazing of cadets by 1873 and made strong efforts to eradicate the discreditable practice in 1871. Other African Americans eventually followed Smith's entrance into West Point, and Henry O. Flipper, who was admitted to the academy in 1873, became the first to graduate from the academy in 1877. In 1874, Smith was forced out of the academy due to having failed an unconventional private test, in defiance of traditional West Point practice, administrated by Professor Peter S. Michie. Smith was finally commissioned an officer by West Point in 1997, 123 years later. Utah Territory polygamy in 1862, during the American Civil War, President Lincoln signed into law the Morrill Bill that outlawed polygamy in all U.S. territories. Mormons who practiced polygamy in Utah for the most part resisted the Morrill law and the territorial governor during the 1868 election. Grant had mentioned he would enforce the law against polygamy. Tensions began as early as 1870, when Mormons in Ogden, Utah began to arm themselves and practice military drilling. By the 4th of July, 1871, Mormon militia in Salt Lake City, Utah were on the verge of fighting territorial troops. However, leveler heads prevailed and violence was averted. President Grant, however, who believed Utah was in a state of rebellion, was determined to arrest those who practiced polygamy. Outlawed under the Morrill Act in October 1871, hundreds of Mormons were rounded up by U.S. Marshals, put in a prison camp, arrested, and put on trial for polygamy. One convicted polygamist received a $500 fine and 3 years in prison under hard labor. On November 20, 1871, Mormon leader Brigham Young, in ill health, had been charged with polygamy. Young's attorney stated that Young had no intention to flee the court. Other persons during the polygamy shutdown were charged with murder or intent to kill. The Morrill Act, however, proved hard to enforce since proof of marriage was required for conviction. On December 4, 1871, President Grant stated that polygamists in Utah were a remnant of barbarism, repugnant to civilization, to decency, and to the laws of the United States. Comstock Act, Main Article, Comstock Laws. In March 1873, anti-obscenity moralists, led by the YMCA's Anthony Comstock, easily secured passage of the Comstock Act, which made it a federal crime to mail articles for any indecent or immoral use. Grant signed the bill after he was assured that Comstock would personally enforce it. Comstock went on to become a special agent of the post office appointed by Secretary James Cresswell. Comstock prosecuted pornographers, imprisoned abortionists, banned nude art, stopped the mailing of information about contraception, and tried to ban what he considered bad books. Early suffrage movement. During Grant's presidency, the early women's suffrage movement led by Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton gained national attention. Anthony lobbied for female suffrage, equal gender pay, and protection of property for women who resided in Washington, D.C. In April 1869, Grant signed into law the protection of married women's property from their husbands' debts and the ability for women to sue in court in Washington, D.C. In March 1870, Representative Samuel M. Arnold introduced a bill, co-authored by suffragist Binette Lockwood, that would give women federal workers equal pay for equal work. 2 years later, Grant signed a modified Senate version of the Arnold bill into law. The law required that all federal female clerks would be paid the fully compensated salary. However, lower-tiered female clerks were exempted. The law increased women's clerk salaries from 4% to 20% during the 1870s. However, the culture of patronage and patriarchy continued. The Republicans, who needed women to campaign for Grant in the 1872 presidential election, added to their platform open discussion of women's rights without actually endorsing women's rights. Economy and treasury reform. On taking office, Grant's first move was signing the act to strengthen the public credit, which the Republican Congress had just passed. It ensured that all public debts, particularly war bonds, would be paid only in gold rather than in greenbacks. The price of gold on the New York Exchange fell to $130 per ounce, the lowest point since the suspension of specie payment in 1862. On May 19, 1869, Grant protected the wages of those working for the U.S. government. In 1868, a law was passed that reduced the government working day to 8 hours. However, much of the law was later repealed that allowed day wages to also be reduced to protect workers. Grant signed an Executive order that no reduction shall be made in the wages regardless of the reduction in hours for the government day workers. Treasury Secretary George S. Boutwell reorganized and reformed the United States Treasury by discharging unnecessary employees, started sweeping changes in Bureau of Printing and Engraving to protect the currency from counterfeiters, and revitalized tax collections to hasten the collection of revenue. These changes soon led the Treasury to have a monthly surplus by May 1869. Boutwell reduced the national debt by $12. Alfred Pleasanton was dismissed for being unqualified to hold the position of Commissioner of Internal Revenue in 1870. Pleasanton, a Grant appointment, approved an unauthorized $60,000 tax refund and was associated with an alleged unscrupulous Connecticut firm. Treasury Secretary George Boutwell promptly stopped the refund and personally informed Grant that Pleasanton was incompetent to hold office, refusing to resign on Boutwell's request. Pleasanton protested openly before Congress. President Grant removed Pleasanton before any potential scandal broke out. Yellowstone, Buffalo, and Conservation. Hayden's map of Yellowstone, 1871. Organized exploration of the Upper Yellowstone River began in fall 1869 when the Cook Folsom Peterson expedition made a month-long journey up the Yellowstone River and into the geyser basins in 1870. The somewhat more official Washburn Langford Doan expedition explored the same regions of the Upper Yellowstone and geyser basins, naming Old Faithful and many other park features. Official reports from Lieutenant Gustavus Cheney Doan and Scribner's monthly accounts by Nathaniel P. Langford brought increased public awareness to the natural wonders of the region, influenced by Jay Cook of the Northern Pacific Railroad and Langford's public speeches about the Yellowstone on the East Coast. Geologist Ferdinand Hayden sought funding from Congress for an expedition under the auspices of the U.S. Geological Survey. In March 1871, Grant signed into law congressional legislation appropriating $40,000 to finance the Hayden Geological Survey of 1871. Hayden was given instructions by Grant's Secretary of Interior, Columbus Delano. The expedition party was composed of 36 civilians, mostly scientists, and two military escorts. Among the survey party were artist Thomas Moran and photographer William Henry Jackson. Hayden's published reports, magazine articles, along with paintings by Moran and photographs by Jackson convinced Congress to preserve the natural wonders of the Upper Yellowstone. On December 18, 1871, a bill was introduced simultaneously in the Senate, by Senator S.C. Pomeroy of Kansas, and in the House of Representatives, by Congressman William H. Clagett of the Montana Territory, for the establishment of a park at the headwaters of the Yellowstone River. Hayden's influence on Congress is readily apparent when examining the detailed information contained in the report of the House Committee on Public Lands. The bill now before Congress has for its objective the withdrawal from settlement, occupancy, or sale, under the laws of the United States, a tract of land 55 by 65 miles, about the sources of the Yellowstone and Missouri rivers, and dedicates and sets apart as a great national park or pleasure ground for the benefit and enjoyment of the people. When the bill was presented to Congress, the bill's chief supporters, ably prepared by Langford, Hayden, and Jay Cook, convinced their colleagues that the region's real value was as a park area, to be preserved in its natural state. The bill was approved by a comfortable margin in the Senate on January 30, 1872, and by the House on February 27. On March 1, 1872, Grant played his role in signing the Act of Dedication into law. It established the Yellowstone region as the nation's first national park, made possible by 3 years of exploration by Cook Folsom Peterson 1869, Washburn Langford Doan 1870, and Hayden 1871. American bison or buffalo. In 1872, around 2,000 white buffalo hunters working between Wichita, Kansas, and Arkansas were killing buffalo for their hides by the many thousands. Acres of land were dedicated solely for drying the hides of the slaughtered buffalo. Native Americans protested at the wanton destruction of their food supply. By 1874, 3,700,000 bison had been destroyed on the western and southern plains of the United States. Concern for the destruction of the buffalo mounted, and a bill in Congress was passed, H.R. 921, that would have made buffalo hunting illegal for whites. Taking advice from Secretary Delano, Grant chose to pocket veto the bill, believing that the demise of the buffalo would reduce Indian wars and force tribes to stay on their respected reservations and to adapt an agricultural lifestyle rather than roaming the plains and hunting. Buffalo ranchers favored the buffalo slaughter to open pasture land for their cattle herds. With the buffalo food supply lowered, Native Americans were forced to stay on reservations. The 1872 Yellowstone Act prohibited fish and game, including buffalo, from wanton destruction within the confines of the park. However, Congress did not appropriate funds or legislation for the enforcement against poaching. As a result, Secretary Delano could not hire people to aid tourists or protect Yellowstone from encroachment. By the 1880s, buffalo herds dwindled to only a few hundred, a majority found mostly in Yellowstone National Park. As the Indian Wars ended, Congress appropriated money and enforcement legislation in 1894, signed into law by President Grover Cleveland, that protected and preserved buffalo and other wildlife in Yellowstone. Grant also signed legislation that protected northern fur seals on Alaska's Pribilof Islands. This was the first law in U.S. history that specifically protected wildlife on federally owned land. Foreign policies. Further information: Hamilton Fish. The foreign policy of the administration was generally successful, except for the attempt to annex Santo Domingo. The annexation of Santo Domingo was President Grant's not unrealistic effort to relieve the plight of blacks in the South during Reconstruction, and was a first step to end slavery in Cuba and Brazil. The dangers of a confrontation with Britain on the Alabama question were resolved peacefully, and to the monetary advantage of the United States, issues regarding the Canadian boundary were easily settled. The achievements were the work of Secretary Hamilton Fish, who was a spokesman for caution and stability. A poll of historians has stated that Secretary Fish was one of the greatest secretaries of states in United States history. Fish was appointed Secretary of State by Grant on March 17, 1869, and served on Grant's cabinet until the end of Grant's second term on March 4, 1877. Afterwards, Secretary Fish briefly served on President Rutherford B. Hayes' cabinet until March 12, 1877. Dominican Republic Annexation Treaty. Main article: Annexation of Santo Domingo. Massachusetts Senator Charles Sumner strongly opposed Santo Domingo annexation. Brady Handy. 1865–1875. In 1869, Grant proposed to annex the independent, largely black nation of the Dominican Republic, then known as Santo Domingo. Previously in 1868, President Andrew Johnson had attempted to annex the Dominican Republic and Santo Domingo, but the House of Representatives defeated two resolutions for the protection of the Dominican Republic and Santo Domingo and for the annexation of the Dominican Republic. In July 1869, Grant sent Orville E. Babcock and Rufus Ingalls, who negotiated a draft treaty with Dominican Republic President Buenaventura Baez, for the annexation of Santo Domingo to the United States and the sale of Samana Bay for $2.